The date is November 6th, 1997. The survivor is Elsa Ross. The interviewer's name is Marilyn Chuck. We're in San Francisco, California, in the United States of America, and the language is English. I am Marilyn Chuck, and this is an interview with Elsa Ross. Today is November 6th, 1997. We're in San Francisco, California, in the United States of America, and we'll be conducting the interview in English. Good morning.
Good morning, Marilyn.
Could you please tell me your name and spell it?
My name is Elsa Ross. The first name is E-L-S-A. The last name is R-O-S-S.
And what was your maiden name? And please spell that.
My maiden name was Spiedbaum. S-Z-P-I-D-B-A-U-M.
What was your date of birth and what is your age?
My date of birth is November the 2nd, 1936, and I am now 61 years old.
Where were you born?
I was born in Warsaw, Poland.
What was your father's name?
My father's name was Mieczysław Spiedbaum.
Could you spell his first name, please?
M-I-E-C-Z-Y-S-L-A-W.
What was his date of birth?
I don't know. I think probably the year was 1900, somewhere around 1900.
Where was he born?
I believe in Warsaw also.
Do you know his parents' names?
Yes, they were Eliash and Ruth Spiedbaum.
And would you spell the father's first name?
E-L-I-A-S-Z.
Where were they born?
I don't know where my grandfather was born, but my grandmother was born in Częstochowa, which I just recently found out.
And where is that?
That's Poland also.
Do you know what large city that was near?
Pardon? I think that itself is a fairly large city.
Is that right? And what was your mother's name?
My mother's name was Halina.
Spelled?
H-A-L-I-N-A.
And her maiden name?
Zaiden Ross.
Again, to spell and cited. This will be the close to the last one.
Z-A-J-D-E-N-R-O-S.
When was she born?
I don't know.
Can you be approximate? Was she younger than your father by about how much?
I would say that they were probably very close in age. And since his birth date might be 1900... Probably 1900, 1901.
Where was she born?
I can only guess Warsaw also.
Do you know her parents' names?
Just the last name, Zaiden Ross.
Okay. That was your mother's maiden name.
Okay. Yes.
Did you have any siblings? Brothers?
I did not, no.
Okay. Do you remember anything of your grandparents?
No. I've been told a few things. I've been told that my grandfather on my father's side was a rabbi, but he later became a businessman.
You can't think of going to Grandma and Grandpa's house when you were young for a meal or to visit, or them ever coming to your house?
Unfortunately, I myself can't remember going there, but I have been told that we used to all get together at their house on Fridays and Friday nights and have the meal over there the Friday night meal.
What did your father do for a living?
My father, his last occupation, I don't know what he did before then, he had a small business, a factory, where he manufactured little papers, candy wrappers, for my grandfather's factory.
What kind of factory did your grandfather have?
My grandfather had a chocolate and candy factory in Warsaw.
Did you enjoy sweets when you were a little girl? Do you remember eating them?
I don't remember eating sweets, which is really strange, but I remember playing. I do remember playing with the candy wrappers.
What'd you do with them?
Well, I would look at them. You know, they came in little stacks. And the stacks were quite high, you know, and I suppose I was very small, and I remember sitting on a potty, you know. I suppose I was being potty trained. And they'd give me these little stacks of papers, and they all had pictures on them. And, you know, I've seen similar ones, so I presume these look sort of like them, of different fruits. So each candy had a fruit filling in it, you know. And so there would be little oranges on some, and apples and strawberries, that sort of thing.
What kind of a man was your father? How do you remember him?
I only remember that he must have been, he must have indulged me a lot, you know, because he used to bring me Shirley Temple rings and all sorts of Shirley Temple things, you know, which I suppose were very much very popular at the time. And I do remember that I was once leaning over a balcony, because there was a balcony in the apartment where we lived, and he got very angry and pulled me off the balcony. Those are the two memories I have.
Do you have any visual memory of him? Can you see
no,
him?
No, I can't see him.
Okay. Can you think of any things you ever did together? Any places you went?
No, I can't remember anything.
You can't think of maybe if the family going on a vacation someplace or an outing someplace?
Unfortunately, I can't.
That's okay. I mean, it's fine if you can't, but maybe if I ask a question, you can. So,
I hope so.
Okay. Do you know if the family had a car?
I don't know.
Okay, so you have no recollection of going on cars or buses with the family?
No, none whatsoever.
What about your mother? Did your mother work?
Yes, she did work.
What did she do?
She did secretarial work.
Do you remember her going off to work? Did she work after you were born?
Yes, she did work after I was born. I can't remember her going off to work. I've been told that she worked mainly to put her sister and brothers through university.
Who was home with you when she worked?
I was told I had a nanny, a German nanny, and then I think there was also a maid there.
Can you come up with any pictures or images of being with this nanny or the maid? Anything you did with her or?
No, but I was told that they used to, that the nanny used to take me out in a pram to a park nearby where she would meet other nannies with babies.
Did she do the cooking, do you think?
I don't think so. I think it was the other person who did the cooking.
Do you remember what she cooked?
No, no.
Do you remember your room?
I can't remember my room.
The kitchen, the hall, anything? You remember the balcony?
Yes.
Anything inside the apartment?
No, nothing.
No furniture?
And then, too, I only remember the balcony because I have a photo of it. And I do remember, I have another photo with my parents in it, and, you know, there's some furniture in that photo.
Can you remember any parties at your home, birthday parties, or?
No, none whatsoever.
Okay. Do you remember any books that you had?
No, not at that time.
Songs that you knew?
No.
Do you think you were a happy child or a sad child?
I can't remember. I think I must have been rather happy. I think I must have been happy.
Were you at all aware of the Nazis entering Poland?
No.
Did you sense or can you recall any tension in the home about war or anybody in the neighborhood disappearing? Anything that would cause
tension? You mean before the war started or before the war?
While you were still living at your home?
No.
Did you know there was was there talk of moving?
I can't remember it.
Okay. Do you remember leaving your home at all?
No.
Do you know if your family did leave your home and if so, where they went?
I can only surmise that the street where I lived, Pańska, was not in the ghetto. But I'm not sure about that either.
So do you think your family moved to a ghetto?
I think so.
I
do have memories of, and these are my own memories, of hiding under furs in my grandfather's factory or somewhere near there. Hiding under furs, playing under furs.
Do you think you were sleeping there also, staying there?
Not in the factory, no.
So that was during the day?
It was during the day, yes.
Who was with you?
It's a very vague memory. I can't remember who was with me.
Do you think you were alone, or were there other people?
There were other people. It's not a frightening memory at all. But it's a very, very sharp, clear memory that I have of actually being sort of covered by furs or feeling the furs. So, but that's all I remember, and that's my own clear memory. Sort of.
When you lived in the ghetto,
yes.
Do you have any recollection of what your living quarters were at all? Do you remember a different place than where you used to live?
Yeah. Well, I remember that the quarters were very cramped. I remember maybe a small room.
And who do you think lived in that room?
I think my mother, my father, and I.
Do you remember what you did all day when you lived in the ghetto?
No, nothing at all.
You stayed in the room, or did you go outside?
I can't remember going outside of the room. I can't remember any meals. I remember being told not to sneeze or not to make too much noise because someone might hear me making the noise.
Did your father still go to work?
I don't remember.
Do you think he still had his business then?
I don't know.
Did you know you were Jewish?
I was told that just before I was separated from my parents.
Do you remember what you were told?
At the time when I was separated, I was told never to tell anyone that I was Jewish.
Before you were separated, can you remember any feelings of fear or awareness that something was wrong? were different?
Well, only sort of stifling the cough or the sneeze.
But did you know why?
No. No. I also have a memory of my mother sitting by a sewing machine crying. And I don't know if that was in the ghetto in that room or not. I suspect it might have been.
Do you have any recollection of how that made you feel?
Well, just the fact that I remember it, it must have had a tremendous impact on me. And now I do remember a memory. It's just come back to me. I mean, I did remember it before, but I've forgotten. Before the ghetto, being in the apartment, in some apartment before the ghetto room, where I was playing with my mother's makeup, her lipstick, and she was angry because I got it all over me.
You think you were in your parents' bedroom?
I think so, yes.
Were you looking in a mirror?
Probably, because...
But you don't remember
I
that?
I can't remember, but I had it. I had the lipstick smeared all over me.
Can you remember your mother's face at that point? What she looked like?
No, no.
Were you close with your mother?
I think so, yes.
Did your parents wear a yellow star in the ghetto?
Can't remember.
Or if you wore one either, you can't
remember. No.
Okay. So, were your grandparents in the ghetto with you?
They were in the ghetto.
They were. Do you remember seeing them there?
No, I don't.
So the only thing, the only people you remember from the ghetto then were your mother and father. No friends?
And no. Really, not even my father being in the ghetto.
So it's possible that he was at work then or out?
Yes, because I only remember my mother being sitting at the sewing machine. So I really am not sure even if that was in the ghetto. But she was crying.
Who told you that you were going to leave the ghetto?
Nobody. But at the time when it happened, I remember people saying to me, voices telling me to run.
To run from what?
To run out of the ghetto. It was a street scene, I remember, at night, to run toward a truck that was waiting for me and to jump into it.
Whose voice do you remember?
I can't remember if it was a man or a woman.
Did you say goodbye to your mother?
Can't remember.
Do you remember the running?
I do. I can remember.
So you ran out of your house? Or you
I just remember the street scene, being out in the street, being told to run fast and
how
to jump in.
How many people were there?
I can't remember.
Can you remember once you ran to the truck, who was in the truck?
No.
You don't know if you were alone in the truck or if there were other children?
No, I can't remember anything like that.
Do you have any idea how long you rode in the truck?
Not too long at all.
Could you guess how long that would be? Would it be an hour or?
No, no.
Not even
no,
an hour?
Not even an hour.
Half an hour.
Maybe less.
Maybe less, okay. When the truck stopped, you don't remember who was driving the truck?
I don't.
Okay, when the truck stopped, do you remember what you saw?
No, but I do know that I went into an apartment. I mean, these were people who taught me some Catholic prayers.
So to back up, do you remember who told you any instructions before you left about not being, were you told to say you were not Jewish?
Jewish, right.
Was that
to never tell anybody that I was Jewish.
And who told you that?
It seems to me like it might have been my mother.
When you got to this apartment, do you have any idea who these people were?
No.
What did they teach you?
They taught me a few Catholic prayers.
Do you remember them?
Not right now, no. I mean, I'm sure, I think one of them was Our Father, which art in heaven, you know, but in Polish.
Do you remember it in Polish?
I was trying to think of it now. I can't remember. I know it. It's somewhere in the back of my mind in Polish, because I've said it in Polish as an adult. No, not right now. Bit nervous.
Do you have any idea how long you stayed there?
Not very long. But in order to learn, yes, I did. In order to learn the prayers, I might have stayed for more than one day.
And do you remember any other children there?
No.
Do you remember whether the adults were, was it a man or a woman or?
Probably both, a couple.
Can you remember what the place looked like?
No.
When you left, who took you out of that home?
I don't remember.
How did you get to the next place?
Can't remember either.
Where did you go?
To an orphanage outside of Warsaw.
Do you remember how long it took to get there?
No, I don't remember. I do remember that I had some clothes with me.
Any toys, books? Did you take any favorite things with you?
No, but I remember some clothes, and I particularly remember a little black velvet dress. And I remember I had to give these things to someone at the orphanage who told me that these things would be shared among other children and that I could not have all of those things for me.
Do you think you understood what was happening?
No, not at all.
Do you remember if you cried? Were you frightened?
I can't remember. I think maybe I do remember being ill at ease at the apartment where I learned how to pray in Polish, say Catholic prayers.
What did the orphanage look like? Was it a large building, a small building?
I don't know what it looked like from the outside, but I remember a large room where a lot of us slept all
How
together.
Many?
I can't remember exactly.
What year was it that you got to the orphanage?
I don't know.
About how old were you?
I think I might have been 4.
So that would have been what year?
1941.
Were there any adults sleeping in the room with you?
No, but there were older girls. I can't remember adults.
About what age range were the children?
Probably my age to teenagers. Or
think there were other Jewish children there?
I don't know.
Did you feel different than the other children?
No.
Did you make friends?
I think so. Probably I did.
Did you ever talk over your situation with any of the adults there?
I do believe I talked with the head nun, And she, in fact, might have told me not to tell anyone that I was Jewish.
Do you remember the name of any of the nuns?
No, no.
Did you ever go outside the orphanage to play? Was there a playground or a yard?
There was an area outside. I remember running out of the orphanage when there was an air raid toward a shelter. And obviously I wasn't running fast enough because they were telling me to run faster. And I remember an explosion very close by, a bomb dropping somewhere nearby, shrapnel. But it didn't hit me. None of it hit me.
Do you remember being frightened of it?
That I do remember, yes.
Did someone comfort you?
I can't remember anyone comforting me. I can't even remember getting to the shelter.
Can you remember on the way back from the shelter what the building looked like? Was it a large building?
I think it was fairly large. There was a dining area. There was an area where they kept flour, because I remember rats running around near the flour and rat droppings. I remember another fairly large room, what seems in my mind to be a large room, where we used to put on plays, little plays. And I remember flower costumes. And I remember being told that we couldn't read Polish books. We couldn't study. We were not allowed to study.
Was there a school in the orphanage?
I don't think so. But why? I wonder why we were allowed to put on a play and have sort of a daisy-like costume. And yet we were not allowed to read Polish books.
Not allowed to read any books, or
no.
Just Polish books?
Well, Polish books, and we couldn't speak any other language, so. I guess we were supposed to be studying in German. I don't know.
Did you speak German?
No, no.
Do you think they taught you German?
I can't remember being taught German at all. Not then. I can remember also Polish soldiers in trenches nearby speaking to us. They used to talk to us.
What did they say?
I can't remember. They were standing in the trenches.
Do you remember talking to them?
I suppose we talked back, yes.
Okay, we're going to change the tape.
Oh.
And be right. Do you remember having any visitors?
Yes.
Who?
A friend of a friend of my mother's used to come to visit me every Sunday at the orphanage.
What was her name?
Her name was Halina Liszewska.
Did you remember her from before?
No, no.
Tell me about what you remember of her visits.
Well, I remember she would bring me food. She'd bring me white bread, which was a delicacy, because most of the bread was black, I think. And she would bring some ham, maybe, on the bread. But I don't know if she always was able to bring the ham. I looked forward to her visits very much.
Was she Jewish?
She was not Jewish.
Did you remember her from before? Did you know she was your mother's friend before you went there?
No, no.
Did you ever get any mail while you were there?
None.
So, did she, when she came to visit, did she have news of your parents? Do you remember discussing that?
No, I don't remember discussing that at all.
Did you have any idea where your parents were?
No, no. I seem to be one of these people who doesn't ask enough questions. I might have always been like that. And maybe it started early on, this business of not asking questions, and it has continued.
Was there a window in your room?
At the orphanage? I can't remember.
Can you remember if there were mountains around you, or what the countryside looked like at all? What could you see?
It must have been flat. It must have been fairly flat.
Why do you say that?
Because I can't remember climbing any places. I can't remember going uphill. I really can't remember anything difficult about the terrain. And the only memory, of course, the only real memory is that memory of running from the orphanage to the shelter, and also seeing the soldiers in the trenches. And now I remember things growing in the fields. That's interesting.
What was growing?
I can't remember how high it was, whatever was growing there.
What color was it?
I remember sunflowers. Big sunflowers. Yeah.
Do you remember any water nearby? Lake, no. River?
No.
Can you think of any time during the time you were there, of a typical day? Can you tell me what you did during the day? From the time you woke up till you went to bed, whatever you remember.
I just remember the highlight of the day, which was standing in line to get a square piece of bread which had been dipped in cod liver oil. We all looked forward to that very, very much, and it tasted wonderful. I also remember mealtime, where we ate something called prazhuha. I have no idea if that was a mixture of flour and potatoes, but I think it might have been exactly that.
Do you remember being hungry or being full at the orphanage?
Well, I can't remember being hungry, but we must have really longed for food, because to be so excited when we stood in line for that little piece of bread with cod liver oil on it makes me think that that was something very, very special, a delicacy for us. Even more so than the bread that my friend's mother used to bring on Sundays.
Do you remember having to go and say the prayers?
You know, that's interesting. I think I remember saying the prayers, but I don't know when we said them. I can't remember what time of day.
You think you said them once every day, though? Or more than once?
Definitely once a day, but I can't remember when.
Did you ever feel Catholic?
Yes, I felt very Catholic.
What did you do with the part of you that was Jewish?
Completely, completely forgot it, buried it. Probably didn't forget it, sorry, that's not the word. Just simply stifled it.
Do you use your real name when you were in the orphanage?
No, I didn't. My new name, my Catholic name, my Polish name was Elżunia Zalewska.
Can you spell those?
E-E-E-L-Z-U-N-I-A was the first name, and that's a diminutive of Elżbieta. Zalewska was Z-A-L-E-W S-K-A.
Who told you that would be your name?
I can't remember. I can't remember if it was before I got to the orphanage, at the house of the people who taught me the Catholic prayers, or... it might have been there.
Do you remember if you had trouble remembering your new name?
Well, I was always Arjunia. That was a sort of a diminutive that I was called by my parents. So really the only name that changed was the last name. And that... I don't know if my real name had made an impact on me before then.
Do you remember if the orphanage was ever visited by soldiers or anybody looking for Jews?
I remember it was visited. I don't know if they were looking for Jews.
Were you frightened soldiers. When it happened?
Maybe not soldiers, but probably so. Yes.
You were frightened?
I think so.
Do you remember what you did when they came?
No, I remember... that might have been when we might have had to hide some books.
Tell me about hiding the books.
I don't know, but we might have been actually reading or... looking at books. And I think we had to get rid of them.
Did you ever practice what you would say if anybody questioned you whether you were Jewish? Did you think about what you would do?
Well, I think at the very beginning when I got there and the headmistress or the head nun told me never to tell anyone that I was Jewish. I think that was very much on my mind at that time. It might have stayed on my mind for quite a while. I don't know.
Did you ever share it with any of the children there?
I don't think so.
How old were you when you entered the orphanage?
Probably 4.
And when you left?
8.
During that time, did they teach you anything to read, to write?
I don't think much of anything, no.
Did you play during the day? What did you do?
No, it's amazing to me that all I can remember is the plays, the little play we put on. I can't remember playing. I can't remember anything we did.
Were there birthday parties for you when your birthday came?
No.
What happened when your birthday came?
I don't know. I can't remember the passage of time.
What about Christmases?
Can't remember celebrating Christmas either.
Any presents at all during that time?
No.
Do you think you knew about the war during that time? Did the nuns tell you what was going on?
Well, I did know about the war because of the soldiers in the trenches and the bomb.
So you think the nuns may have explained that?
Possibly.
But you don't remember?
I don't.
What were your feelings about Catholicism at the time?
Very positive.
What was your feeling about God?
I don't remember any feelings about God.
Did you think of your parents?
I must have. I think I must have really missed them because at the very end when the war was over, and one of my aunts came to get me. I thought she was my mother. And then when she told me she wasn't my mother, I was terribly upset. I must have longed for my parents.
At the orphanage, were you ever punished?
I don't remember being punished.
Can you remember any pleasant moments?
No. Just that same memory of the play.
Still no special friends come to mind? Nobody you slept next to and talked to?
Just an older girl that I can't see her face. I can't remember her name. But I think she was told to take care of me.
Do you remember being with her at all?
No. Not during the day. More at night time.
What happened then?
I can't remember if she slept next to me or not.
Do you think she helped you dress or wash
or bathe? She might have helped me. Certainly she was there at the very beginning. Probably when I first arrived there, although I'm not sure. But it might have been at the very beginning. Because I don't remember her later on, you know, later, while I was still there.
What do you remember about that would be the most difficult or frightening thing that happened the whole time you were there?
Just the incident with the bomb was very frightening. That was very frightening.
I'm sorry.
Difficult. I was trying to think. Probably not having much to eat.
Other than the normal passage of time growing up, how do you think you changed in the orphanage?
I don't know. I do think that this Catholicism that was instilled in me at the time has had a tremendous impact on my whole life.
How?
I still like Catholic churches. I still like the ritual of the Catholics' Mass. I know it in Latin, many parts of it.
Can you say a part for me?
No, not right now. I'm not. But when I'm in a Catholic church, for some reason I can remember the prayers in Latin and say them.
How did you hear about the end of the war?
That's when my aunt Irene came to. Oh, I see. I can't remember anyone saying, "Wow, the war is over, let's celebrate." Nothing like that. But I do remember my aunt coming to get me and someone telling me that the war was over.
Do you know how long after the war was over she arrived?
No. Okay. Not right away, I don't think. A few months after, maybe.
When you thought that your aunt was your mother, and she...
Yes.
Did she tell you where your mother was or what happened to your mother?
Yes.
What did she tell you?
She told me my mother was no longer alive and that she was not my mother.
Do you remember how you reacted?
I was terribly disappointed. I cried.
Did you ask about your father also?
No.
Did she tell you?
No. She just looked like my mother. She reminded me of my mother. I must have remembered my mother then.
Whose sister was she, your mother's or your father's?
Actually, she was married to one of my father's brothers.
How old were you when your aunt came for you?
I think I must have been 8.
Where did she take you?
She took me to Krakow.
Why Krakow?
I don't know. I think she was already living there with her son.
How did you get to Krakow?
I can't remember. I can't remember leaving the orphanage.
When you got to Krakow, do you remember where you stayed? Do you remember what the place looked like?
Yes, I do remember we stayed in an apartment of a friend of my aunt's. I can't remember his name. And the apartment was much, well, it was bigger than the room in the ghetto.
And how long did you stay there?
I think just a few months. But I had to share the room with her son.
How old was her son?
Oh, he's just a few months younger than I am.
Were you happy to be out of the orphanage? Yeah.
You know, I can't remember. I can't remember being that much happier. But I definitely remember a great difference.
What was the difference?
The difference was freedom. And the difference was being able to go out in the street and talk to people in the street and talk with Russian soldiers who used to give us candy and go out with my cousin who was my age, who was 8 years old, and he used to buy me ribbons because I liked ribbons.
Did you go back to your real name at that point?
I can't remember. I can't remember if it was then or later.
Did you ever go to a DP camp, displaced persons camp?
Do you mean in Poland, yes. Right after the war?
Yes.
No.
Okay. What was Krakow like at that point? What do you remember seeing? Were there signs of war that you can remember?
No, I can't remember any signs of war. I can remember that the Russian soldiers were very, very nice to us. And they were all over the place, you know. And they talked to us children, and they were very friendly.
When you left Krakow, did you leave with your Aunt Irene?
I can't remember when exactly my other aunt came to get me, to take me away from Aunt Irene.
Who was this other aunt?
My other aunt, who kept me from then until the age of 16, was my father's twin sister.
What was her name?
Her name was Anna.
Why did Anna keep you rather than Irene?
Anna kept me because she had lost her child in a concentration camp. And she said to Aunt Irene, "You have a son. Your son survived. My son didn't. So I'm going to take her."
Do you know what concentration camp she was in?
Paviak is one of them. She was in more than one.
Did she lose anyone else besides her son?
Yes, she did.
Who else?
She lost her very beloved husband. And she was extremely, extremely devoted to him and her son.
So did she take you out of Krakow?
Yes, she did. Because she became, for a while only, and a short while only, the headmistress of a little school or a camp for children who were orphaned during the war, Jewish children.
Where?
That place was also outside of Warsaw. I can't remember exactly. I can't remember the name of the place. But she was in charge.
And did you stay with her or with the children when you got there?
She was very strict. She made me stay with the children. I had no preferential treatment whatsoever.
And what was life like there?
I seem to remember it as being sort of nice. I was pestered by my cousin, who came along too. His name is Ted.
How long did you stay there?
I think very short time.
And then when did you go?
From that place, we left Poland.
Do you have any idea how they were able to leave Poland?
I think, in fact, I don't think, I know that my uncle's good friend was the Minister of Health at the time in Poland, and he helped us get out of Poland very quickly.
What year was that?
It must have been in 1945, 46, maybe.
Do you know his name?
No, I don't remember the name of the Minister of Health.
What about your uncle's name, then?
My uncle? Henrik Spiedbaum.
And where did your aunt and uncle and you go when you left Poland?
Well, my uncle was already with the Polish army in Italy. And my aunt and I were smuggled out of Poland. She was, I think, a Red Cross nurse or something like that. At least she had on the uniform of the Red Cross. And I was smuggled in a truck also, hidden under whatever covers there were in the back of the truck. And that's how we got out.
Could you clarify, please? You had just said that your uncle's friend was the minister, so, and that he helped. Did he help with your needing to be smuggled out? Or
I don't know exactly how it happened, but probably so. My uncle was a doctor, so they may have been old friends from medical school. Yes.
And you think he was able to make the arrangements for you to be smuggled in a truck?
I do think so.
And where?
And we went to through Switzerland.
And then were you reunited with your aunt when you got to Switzerland?
My aunt was in the same truck.
I'm sorry. I meant
she
uncle.
And I only. I mean, and then somehow we I don't know when we got out of the truck, but I remember going through Switzerland and on a train. So we left the train, because I remember going through tunnels, through mountains, through mountains, tunnels. And I remember looking out of a train window, and I remember drawing and cutting dolls, and that was in the train. And that was going out of, leaving Poland, going toward my uncle who was in Italy.
Did you meet? So you met up with your uncle in Italy?
Yes, we did.
And where did you stay when you got to Italy?
We were in Bologna. We were in Bologna. I think Ancona too, which was very close to Bologna. And my uncle had had a massive heart attack, so he was in a hospital in Bologna.
And where did you and your aunt stay?
In Bologna, in a home with an Italian family.
Do you know how they knew this family?
No,
Do you know who the family was?
No. It wasn't a family that they had known before the war. It was just an Italian family.
How long did you stay in Bologna?
In Bologna? Altogether in Italy, we stayed for 1 year. Ancona must have been close, and Ancona must have been Pinocchio. I remember Pinocchio, Ancona, and Bologna. And I remember, I think, one of those towns, probably Pinocchio or Ancona, was a seaside town, because we were on the beach. I have photos of us, of my aunt, with me on the beach.
And did your uncle get out of the hospital and join you?
No. He was very ill. He got married while he was in that hospital. And he was dying.
And did he die there?
No, he didn't. He made it.
And got married?
He got married. I think he got married to this woman he had met during the war, because he thought he would probably die, and he just wanted to get married to her before he died. But it took about a year, and he got better.
So did he leave the hospital before you left Italy?
No, I think we went ahead of him.
Did your aunt ever remarry?
Yes, she did.
When?
She married in England.
So when you left Italy, or before you left Italy, would you say this was a happier time for you in Italy at the seashore?
Oh, it was a wonderful time.
Did you have a good relationship with this aunt?
At that time, I did.
So you were happy there?
I was very happy there. And I loved the beach, and I loved the sea. And I remember all my boils that I had all over my body after the war just disappearing.
Where did you get the boils?
They were all over me.
When? When did they start?
They probably were on me in Poland still.
But at the orphanage? Or after?
Probably at the orphanage too. And I think, I do remember my uncle saying that because we had honey to eat in Italy, the honey helped get rid of the boils.
Do you know what caused the boils?
A lack of food, malnutrition.
Where did you live? Was it an apartment?
In Italy?
Yes, at the seaside.
It was a house, a little house. Yes, I think it might have been a little house.
We're going to change the tapes.
Yeah.
And then...
Yeah.
Did your aunt tell you about her war experiences?
Not much.
What did she tell you?
She told me that she had been in several concentration camps. She told me that a friend of hers, that she was in the concentration camps with some women she knew, that a friend of hers had helped her get a job. That there was no food at all, that they were working very, very hard. That they used to write cookbooks in their cell. I mean, not write them. I don't know if they wrote them. They talked about recipes. I think her job, her friend got her a job as a seamstress. I think also that she might have had to have had an operation. I don't remember what the operation was. It might have been, I don't know, hysterectomy? I'm not sure.
When you were living with her, did you return to Judaism?
No.
What religion were you then?
When we first arrived in England, I made friends with a little girl, and she was Baptist.
Well, we were still in Italy. That's okay.
Oh, in Italy? I can't remember my aunt telling me anything about the concentration camp then.
Okay. So she told you about that in England?
In England.
And what about your religion when you were in Italy? What did you consider yourself when you were in Italy?
Nothing.
And what about your aunt? What, was she Jewish?
I don't know.
So you don't remember any holidays, celebrating any Jewish holidays?
None.
At all?
But you know, the woman that my uncle married in the hospital was Catholic, and he remained married to her. So...
When you left Italy, where did you go?
We went to... Yorkshire, England.
Why did you pick England? Or why did she pick England?
I think I've been told that during the Yalta Conference, there was an agreement made between Stalin, Roosevelt, and Churchill that all members of the Polish army abroad and their families would be allowed to settle in England.
So did your uncle and his new wife join you there?
Yes, they did.
And who did your aunt remarry?
My aunt married a Catholic man who had been in the Polish army abroad.
And what was his name?
His name is a very interesting name. It's Tadeusz Szach Krummel Bey. He had been a baron in Poland.
What did he do for a living in England?
He was a gardener.
They met in England?
Yes, they did.
When you lived with the two of them, what would you say your family life was like? Was it happy? Were they strict?
They were extremely strict. He was extremely strict. He had the idea that you did not, that children were not to be spoiled at all. That if the water was cold, you took a cold shower, and that that was good for you. I don't know if that was from his army days or what.
Did you go to school then?
I went to school immediately, almost immediately we got to England. My aunt didn't remarry until we moved from Yorkshire to London. But while we were in Yorkshire, we were living in a camp called Car Lane Camp, and we were living in Quonset huts, and my aunt and I were living there. And my uncle, who, my father's brother, who had had the heart attack, did not join us there. I didn't see him until we got to London.
But you went to school in Yorkshire?
I did go to school in Yorkshire very quickly. I was very annoyed at having to learn, oh my goodness, somehow or other I missed out a whole part of leaving Poland. First we went to France, and we were in Paris, and we stayed with a friend of the family's in her teeny tiny apartment. And we stayed there for a few weeks, I think. And so I had to learn a little bit of French. And then when we were in Italy for a year, I had to learn Italian. So that by the time I got to England, I was very annoyed at having to learn another language.
And how long did it take you to learn it?
Not very long. Not very long at all, because maybe 2 years.
How did the children react to having a child with very little English? Were there other children there who spoke Polish or
In England? No, well, not that I know of, not in Yorkshire. I can't remember. I went to a little school in a town called Willoughby. No, I think it was Willoughby. Close to that camp, Car Lane Camp. I think we were in Willoughby near Hull. That's right. And there was a wonderful teacher there called Mrs. Ward, and she worked with me. And she worked very hard with me to learn, to teach me. I had a very hard time with English. First of all, I was bucking it because I didn't want to learn another language. But I had a very hard time learning how to pronounce the word the. T-H-E, you know. I used to say the, and she'd say no, the. And she really was an excellent teacher, and she made sure that I learned it correctly.
How did you get along with the other children?
Now that you ask me, I think that they weren't all that nice to me.
Did you tell them about your experience?
No. I don't think so.
What religion were you at that point?
Well, I can't remember when I met the girl who was Baptist and when I became a Baptist, but that's what happened.
How old were you?
Nine.
Do you remember the girl?
Her first name was Jacqueline. I can't remember her last name.
What about her or her religion impressed you enough to take on a religion?
Well, you know, that's interesting. I suppose she was my best friend. And somehow or other, her mother was very helpful to us. And I just wanted to belong. So.
Did you go to church with her?
I must have, yeah.
How did your aunt feel about that?
Well, you know, she sort of liked it because she became a Baptist herself. And she remained a Baptist till the end of her life. So she was very confused because she had Judaism pulling very strongly at her. And then she went to a Baptist church in London till the very end.
How old were you when you left Yorkshire?
Either 9 or 10.
Why did you leave?
Because my uncle wanted to live in London, and he had sent my aunt, his sister, ahead of time to purchase a house for us. And I think she purchased 2 houses, and I really don't know where the money came from. But he had some money. And we lived in one house, and he lived in the other one with his wife.
Were the houses close to each other?
Pretty close. They were both in Woolston, in London. And the house where we lived, both houses, we had tenants in them. I suppose that helped pay.
Were the tenants actually living with you, or were they different flats?
No, actually, they were different rooms. We shared a bathroom.
What about mealtime?
No. The house where I lived with my aunt, we had a dining room, a kitchen. I slept in the dining room, and my aunt slept with her new husband in their bedroom.
So the people who slept in these other rooms didn't eat with your family?
No, they didn't. We had the kitchen. I don't even know if they had a kitchen.
Were you friendly with any of these people? Did you?
Yes, we were. I mean, I remember an Irish family living in one room with a baby.
What else do you remember?
I remember that I had to help my aunt with the household chores, and I thought that she asked me to do too much.
Did you go back to school in England? In London, rather?
I did. And I was very lucky. I passed an exam which got me into a college prep school.
And how long did you stay in London?
From the age of 10 to 18 or 19.
And lived with your aunt?
Lived with my aunt until I was 16. Then I ran away from her and her husband and moved in with my uncle and his wife.
Why did you run away from your aunt?
She was a strict disciplinarian, particularly with me. She was already a teacher. She went back to her profession, which was teaching. She had learned English, and she got a very nice job, finally, after having been a maid, etc. She taught in a really nice school in London. And I think she was very kind to her pupils there, but she was extremely strict with me.
Do you think her war experience, the loss of her husband and child, affected her?
Oh, incredibly.
How?
Well, she'd lose her temper, she'd scream at me, she used to hit me, you know. She was very difficult. She would argue with her brother and not talk to him for months. They had incredibly, these arguments were ridiculous. I mean, they would last for, he was not supposed to be made nervous because of his heart condition, and she would affect him terribly that way by arguing with him.
Do you think she was mentally unstable?
I do. And I have been told that she wasn't all that stable before the war, but I think she was just highly individualistic. You know, she was a person in her own right, and you know, she wasn't like everybody else. But on the other hand, I don't think she was this mentally unstable. I think the war really affected her terribly.
Did it affect her second marriage also?
I think so. She was madly in love with her first husband, and I don't think she ever really could forget him.
But did they stay married?
They did stay married, and toward the end, you know, and just before he died, she was very, very good to him. And in fact, they were quite good to each other once I left.
How long did you stay with your uncle?
I stayed with him until I graduated from high school. I stayed with him and his wife.
What year was that?
I graduated in 1955, I think.
What were your goals at that point?
Well, my goals, it was very interesting. Toward the end of my high school days, I had specialized in languages. I suppose that was the easiest way to go. And I was well prepared for that by my experiences. I was not very good at science and math. And I did want to go to the London School of Economics, but I didn't get in. I applied, but I did not get in.
So what was your next plan?
I had no other plan. It was really sad. You know, they didn't understand the English educational system, my aunt and uncle, and if they did, they really didn't care about it. They didn't care to make sure that I applied to more than one university. And once I didn't get into LSU, that was it, you know. As far as they were concerned, it was just not meant for anything like that, not meant to go to college at all.
So what did you do with yourself?
So I got a job working for the Royal Automobile Club, taking tea to people. Not making it, but just taking it around a cart.
How long did that last?
I think I had it for a year.
And then what did you do?
And then some really nice people came to the United States. They were related to my Aunt Irene. Well, in fact, it was my Aunt Irene's brother and his wife. And they asked me if I wanted to go to the university in the United States. And of course, I just jumped at that opportunity. But I remember all the time that I was living with my aunt and my uncle, especially with my aunt, there was always this business of, would you rather live with someone else? And would you rather leave us? And at the age of 13, my aunt asked me if I would like to come to the United States. And because some people that she knew in Houston wanted to adopt a child. And I was 13 then. And I really didn't want to be adopted at that age. And I think I felt terrible that they would even think of giving me up. So I always had the feeling that I really wasn't wanted.
Do you think you were a difficult child?
I think so, but not terribly difficult.
What do you think you did that made you a difficult child?
Well, while I was in high school, we did steal money out of other children's coats. And I was caught with a few other children. And we were black booked, which was the worst punishment in an English school, because it went down on your record. And if you were black booked often enough, you might not be able to get into college, we were told.
Did you repent, or did you keep up with your life?
No. Well, I mean, you know, I think I was really upset that I was caught. And I think that I was upset that my uncle was very, very mad at me. This was the uncle that my aunt married, who also made me take cold showers. He just thought that, he had wanted me to take his name, which was such a very, very prestigious name because he was a baron. But he said, at that point, I will absolutely not give her my name. And so I stole money. That was one thing I did that was bad. I didn't come straight home from school. You know, I'd sort of hang out with the kids, you know, on the way we walked from school. And I'd take my time and didn't do much housework, didn't do as much as I was supposed to, wasn't as helpful as I was supposed to be.
Did they ever have other children?
No, they didn't.
So how old were you when you left them to go to the United States?
When I left my uncle?
Uncle.
I think I might have been 20.
Where did you end up in the United States?
In Houston, Texas.
And did you get into a university?
I did get into a university. I was told that it wasn't easy to get me in because I didn't have the math necessary. But anyway, they got me into the University of Houston. And I was brought in as a foreign student by the family in Houston.
What was their name again?
Their name was, Martin and Naomi Warren. And Martin Warren was my Aunt Irene's brother. His Polish name was Warszawczyk.
How did you adapt to life in the United States?
Well, first of all, I was really surprised at the University of Houston. It didn't seem like a university at all. There were people going around in blue jeans and cowboy hats and sitting around smoking cigarettes with their feet up on tables and stuff like that. And that just didn't seem like a university atmosphere to me at all. But there were other parts of it that seemed, that were okay, you know. And I had a hard time being in Houston. I had to go to the university by buses. And it was very hot there. And eventually I moved into the dorms. And I just didn't like the University of Houston. But I did meet lots of people there at the time that, you know, I still know today.
Did you get your degree there?
No, I didn't get my degree there. I had met a really nice man called Peter Brown, and he and I were very good friends. Well, in fact, more than that, we were in love. But he got into Middlebury, and at the time when he was going to leave the University of Houston, he suggested that I transfer to the University of Texas, at which point the people who sponsored me said they would wash their hands of me. So I was on my own, and that was that.
Why did they say that?
Well, they said I had come in and I was supposed to stay with them, you know, and just stay with them and go to the University of Houston. And if I wanted to leave, then I was on my own. They weren't going to help me anymore.
So what did you do?
Well, fortunately, I got work, you know, doing a little bit of secretarial work for some of my professors, whom I absolutely adored. I really loved the University of Texas. I was just in heaven there, in Austin. And somehow or other I muddled through financially. It was really hard for me to pay for the tuition and the food and an apartment there. And I was on my own, but my uncle in England occasionally sent me a little bit of money, not much at all, not much. I didn't get any help from anybody much.
What happened to you and Peter?
At the end, just before I graduated, he came to see me and told me he didn't want to marry me. But he was very good about that, in the sense that he did actually come all the way to Austin to tell me that.
After graduation, what did you do for a living?
After graduation, I only had, I didn't even have a green card. I was in the United States as a foreign student, and so I really wasn't allowed to work. And so I went back to England, and I decided that I really didn't want to live in England anymore, so I returned to the United States, and I worked. I did work. I got a job selling clothes.
Did you have a green card the next time?
No, I had a very hard time getting a green card, because on my passport, it says I was born in Poland, and the Polish quota is a long one. But somehow I met I was very lucky. I met a very nice immigration officer, and he did all the legal work, essentially. He said, you get a job and I'll get you the green card. And so I begged and begged and begged for a teaching position. And I did manage to persuade the superintendent of schools there to give me a job teaching. And once he gave me the job, it was like, he'd say, get the green card, I'll give you the job. The people in the immigration would say, get the job, and we'd give you the green card. But that went on for, and I persevered, begged for the job, got the job, and got the green card.
What religion were you at this point?
Oh, I guess Jewish, because the family that brought me to the United States, the Warrens, used to go to temple. I was confused because a lot of the people I was meeting were not Jewish.
What happened to your baptism?
Oh, that I forgot, you know. I dropped it, but my aunt stayed with it.
Did your aunt and uncle ever come to the United States?
Yes, they did.
When?
They came separately. I went to see my uncle when he came to New York, and I went to see my aunt when she came to New York. They had friends there.
Did they come to live there?
No. Just to visit.
Did you and your aunt ever resolve your differences? Did your relationship change?
Toward the end, in a way, they did. You know, once I got married, she softened up a lot. And we used to visit her a great deal. My husband, my ex-husband, and my daughter and I used to visit her a lot. And things did change, but she always insisted that I wasn't clever, that I wasn't this, that I wasn't that, that I didn't do well, and etc., etc.
So when did you marry?
I married in 1964.
What was his name?
Sam Rosenberg, and later he changed his name to Ross.
What did he do for a living?
We changed our name. He was and still is a professor of mathematics at a small Catholic university at the in Houston, the University of St. Thomas.
Was he Catholic or Jewish?
No, he was Jewish. He is Jewish.
Did the two of you belong to a temple?
Yes, we did.
And observe the holidays?
Yes, we did.
Did you know how to observe the holidays? Where
no.
had you?
No, I didn't know much about any of that.
So how did you learn it?
He knew a little bit. He knew quite a bit, in fact, you know. And I learned quite a bit from him.
Do you think that your war experience affected your relationship with your husband?
I certainly do.
How?
I think that I never really knew anything. I just don't really think I knew much about married life. I didn't know much about family life at all. Normal family life, normal married life.
And did you have children?
Yes. We did. Best.
You want to change tapes now? I had just asked you about children.
Yes.
Can you tell me?
And I started crying, which is happy tears. I'm so happy I have a child. I have one child only, and of course she's 30 years old, so she's really not a child anymore, but I always think of her as a child, my child.
Tell me about her.
She's delightful, you know, she's a wonderful, wonderful person. I'm blessed. I'm really blessed to have her.
What's her name?
Her name is... so sad. I'm crying because these are happy, happy tears. But her name is Emma.
And is she married?
She is married now. And she's a wonderful, extraordinary person.
What's her husband's name?
Her husband's name is Victor Del Frate.
Did you raise her Jewish?
Yes, we did.
And is she still Jewish?
Yes, although we don't belong to a temple. She doesn't either, and she's married to a Catholic.
Okay. What schools did she go to?
She went to a wonderful school in Houston called St. John's. She didn't graduate from there. She graduated from a different high school called Lamar. I think St. John's was just too academic for her, although she's very capable. And then she went to the University of New Mexico and graduated from there.
And how long did you stay married to your husband?
20 years.
Why did you leave Texas?
I left Texas after the divorce. I tried to pick up my life in the pieces after the divorce. It was not easy. And then after having tried and tried and tried for 3 years, I just decided I would move to where Emma was. She still had 1 year left of college at the University of New Mexico in Albuquerque. And I just thought, I'll move and I'll buy a house there, and that's that. By then she had met her husband. They weren't married yet. But she more or less knew she would stay there.
And how do you earn a living in New Mexico?
Well, we now have a clothing store together. A women's clothing store, Emma and I. And it's been rough, but we love it. We love working together. We get along very, very well.
Did you ever go back to Warsaw?
Yes, actually I did, but that was a long time ago. I went back when I was expecting Emma, when I was 30 years old.
Did you find your old home?
Well, the street that my home used to be on is now, it has the Palace of Culture built on it.
Did you see?
We did see Mrs. Lyshetska, the lady who used to bring me bread at the orphanage once a week. And it was hard for me, you know. I'm always having to be grateful for everything. And so here she was, this wonderful woman who had risked her life once a week, every week, for a long period of time. But I had to be grateful to her for saving my life, more or less. You know, in a way she saved my life by giving me more food, you know. And so that's one thing I find, that I seem to have to be grateful all the time for being alive, for being taken care of, for having people care for me. And I resent that.
Do you still think about the war experience?
Especially lately.
What haunts you the most? What haunts you the most about it?
Lack of family.
How do you deal with that?
Badly.
Do you get help for it?
I've had a lot of help. I don't anymore because I understand it so well. I'm lonely. I'm more lonely than most people would be, I suppose. Even though I'm with my daughter in the same town, we work together all day. We spend the days together. My mornings are incredibly lonely, and so are my evenings.
Has this affected your daughter or your relationship with her?
I'm sure it puts a lot of pressure on her, but she's very strong. She seems to be extremely strong. It worries me that the pressure is on her, but I can't do anything about it.
Do you have friends or other outside interests other than the store and your daughter?
I have friends. I've finally made some friends in Albuquerque, and I do see them occasionally. As far as outside interests go, I had a lot more while I was married. I'm very tired when I get home from work.
And how do you feel about God now?
I definitely think there is a God. I don't feel that he's necessarily cruel at all. I don't understand this experience that we had to go through. I don't understand it. I've tried to figure it out. It's just impossible.
What religion do you consider yourself now?
I'm very Jewish.
Do you have any message that you would like to give, to pass on?
Well, you asked me, and I think my message is that family is so important. I can't understand all this business of divorces and families not getting along. I try to encourage other people to stay together, unless there's really terrible trouble there, things that are just not workable at all, like, well, alcoholism, stuff like that. But if that doesn't exist in a relationship, I think above all to stay together. I think families are so important, and if there's no family, it's just, life is meaningless.
Thank you.
Thank you. This is my paternal grandmother. The picture was taken in Warsaw, in Poland. Her name was Ruth Spiedbaum.
Okay.
This is my paternal grandfather. His name was Elias Spiedbaum. The picture was probably taken in the late 1890s in Warsaw, Poland. This is a photograph of my parents, taken before the war. It's the only photo I have. My mother's name was Halina Spiedbaum, my father's name Mieczysław Spiedbaum, and that's a photo of me sitting on my mother's knee.
Do you know when it was taken?
Before the war. Don't know the exact year, in Warsaw, in our apartment.
Can you tell how old you were?
I think I might have been two or three. This is a picture of us, the grandchildren, the only three. On the far left is Maciusz. His last name was, his real name was Marceli Margulies. In the center is a photograph of me. I must be close to 4 years old. And to my right is my cousin, who is now living in Oklahoma. His name is Ted Spencer. His name then was Tadeusz Spiedbaum. This is a photograph of my aunt and uncle who took care of me after the war, brother and sister of my father. My aunt's name was Anna Spiedbaum. The photo is taken in her room in her parents' apartment. To her right is my uncle, Henrik Spiedbaum. This is the earliest picture I have of me after the war. It was taken in Paris in 1945. This is a photograph of me and my aunt when we first arrived in England. We lived in a camp that had Quonset huts. The camp was called Carlane Camp. It was in Willoughby, near Hull, in Yorkshire, England.
What year was that?
1947. This is a photograph taken of my ex-husband and myself at some Houston Public Library function in the 70s. This is a photo, interesting, of both my aunts who survived the war. The one on the left took care of me. The one on the right, holding my daughter Emma, is my Aunt Irene, who came to get me out of the orphanage in Poland. The picture was taken in Houston in about 1966. This is a photograph, a darling photograph, of my daughter Emma when she was 18 months old, taken in Houston, Texas. dog. A photograph of Emma, my dog, Lacroix, and myself, taken a few years ago, before she was married, before Emma was married. This is a photograph, which I love, of Emma getting married to her now husband, Victor Delfrate. They're being married outdoors by Judge Brennan in Albuquerque, New Mexico.
When? What year?
3 years ago. Goodness. What? I'm sorry? 84. 1984. Yes.
Would you please introduce your daughter?
This is my daughter, Emma.
Emma, how much did you know of your mother's war experience?
I know a lot about it, but I've never really gotten that involved with learning more about it because it's hard for me to talk about or think about right now.
How old were you when she told you about it?
Gosh, I can't remember. I mean, I've always known about it. I've always known.
How did it affect your relationship with your mother?
I think that now, I mean, growing up, I think we had a very normal relationship, and, you know, I think now, though, as an adult, all of what has happened to my family has made me want to be very close to my mother and my family.
Were you named for one of your mother's relatives?
No, I was actually named after my father's grandmother.
Do you consider yourself a religious person?
No, I'm not religious. Actually, I'm married to a man who's Catholic. Neither one of us is very religious, but I definitely believe in my religion. I would never change my religion, and I believe it's an important part of who I am.
Why did you go into business with your mother?
That's a long story, but it wasn't really planned, but it turned out that way after my parents divorced and my mother moved out to Albuquerque, where I went to school. She decided to do something new with her life, and I had always planned on having a clothing store, and I thought I would go away to New York to study, but it happened a lot faster this way, and so I went right into business with her.
How would you describe your mother to a stranger?
I would describe her as a really warm and wonderful person. And everyone who meets her just thinks that she's just the most charming, wonderful woman that they've ever met. They all remember her always.
Is there anything that you would like to say to your mother now?
No, she knows everything. She knows I love her so much, and she's just my best friend, and she's my partner in business, and I love having her with me all the time, and she's a huge part of my life.
And is there something you want to say to your daughter?
That I couldn't love a daughter more, that I'm so thrilled to have her. I couldn't imagine being without her. She's the best person in the world.
Thank you.
If you had children, what message would you like to pass on to them about this experience that your family has had?
I think when I do start having a family, I think I'll probably be much more prepared to learn more about the Holocaust and my roots and kind of get into a little bit more, because I think it's important for them to know as much about it as possible. And the thing that's great now is that, you know, in the last 10 years, children have been learning so much more in school, just in daily life, about the Holocaust, whereas when I went to school, that was not a subject that we studied. I think it's really important, and I'll definitely want to learn more and teach them as much as I can.
Is there anything else that you remember or that you want to add to this interview?
No, I don't remember anything at this point that I would like to add. I'm just so glad that this interview was taken, and thank you so much for the opportunity to have had this interview.
Thank you.
Thank you.